apresentação. Today's lecture is by Sérgio Pontão. He's from the Instituto Pasteur de Montevideo.
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 No, it's okay. It's just joking.
MD. MD. So, his lecture is about coarse grain approach to the Syrah forest field. Although he's from Uruguay, he's not the Tanat.
No, unfortunately, I didn't find an acronym yet for that. So, thank you very much, Monir. I would like to spend 2 minutes to say that. There's kind of bad news. The guy who Munir mentioned yesterday and Fernando and I don't know who else is not coming, so they sent me. There's no this big guy named Sergio Pantano. It's just it was me sitting there. I didn't make such a big word. I just sent a few emails and tried to contact some people. And I'm really happy that actually we made it to make something like a second edition of the meeting we had last year in Montevideo. and I hope that this will continue because I really think that we have a lot of potential here. I will a brief outlook of the talk is going to be about a few methods for coarse graining very rapidly, and then we are going to go to what we are doing in Montevideo, and then I would like to show you some examples of what you can do with that. Essentially applied to the study of viral capsids or viral envelopes. Okay, a very very short version of this lecture was already given by Fernando yesterday when he said this is like playing God, and I could end the presentation right there because essentially the idea is, for sure you have heard about a sentence attributed to Einstein saying that things should be explained in the simplest way possible, but not simpler. This is essentially the only rule. The idea is the idea that they teach me many years ago in the graduate school in physics, and is that you have to, ideally you should be able to simplify the theory as much as you can, but still keeping some of the important interactions that in the system that you want to describe. And this, the story of the coarse grain approach is kind of a relatively new name, in the last 10 years or something like that. But if you go back in physics and chemistry, everything is coarse grain. Because at the very end, we should be only speaking about Schrödinger equation. The problem is that we don't know how to solve it, or we don't have the big computers to solve that. So atomistic simulations are already a coarse grain version quantum. And already quantums have some kind of coarse grained versions because you are not considering all quantum effects. so you are kind of going coarser and coarser and coarser. Okay? Just because I like to start with it, with acknowledgement at the beginning, because eventually I will run out of time. The things we are going to see, well, these are most of the people that's involved here. Florencia in the audience should be here, but I don't have a picture. Essentially, the things that I will show you have been done by Humberto Gonzalez, who unfortunately left the group, and this beautiful lady here, who's also in the audience. It's a kind of 10 years younger version of Matthias. We all work or have worked here in the Instituto Pasteur Montevideo. It's an international network of institutes. This is the second newly created in the world, and essentially the idea of what we do is related with the conception we have about the modeling and simulation, and it also has to do with something that Fernando said yesterday, that working in South America, you really have to take the best of your mind to save money. I heard a nice sentence that says like doing science in South America is like to try to make fruit salad with 2 lemons. And so I will show you about our 2 lemons here. But as I was saying, in physics or chemistry, whatever you want, we have devised methods to treat at a very rigorous level all kinds of, can you see? No. Yeah, right? All kinds of phenomena going from enzyme reactions up to, I don't know, protein folding, cell division, and etc. And the problem is that we don't have the computers to treat all these kind of phenomena. So if you want to go to a full quantum calculation, actually, you will be able to eventually to follow some enzyme reactions. And this is the yeah, but they will not. I will have to be crossing every time, but it's okay. So you will not you will not fall asleep. So eventually, I mean, you can go quantum calculations for very small systems or relatively small systems. If the systems go,
I'm sorry.
Yeah, it's okay. Sure.
We should have done that long ago.
Okay, now you grant me 10 more minutes.
Yes. 20. Okay. This is a live stream. This.
This is a packing problem.
Much better.
Much better? Okay? Great. So I was saying that if the systems grow in size or in the characteristical times that you need to describe that, then you are going to resign in precision and going from quantum to classical and then to Coarse-Grained models and then eventually to mesoscale and then to continuum mechanics or more mathematical descriptions of the systems. And this goes this goes growing in this direction, right? So one single protein assemblies with membranes or complicated stuff as the one that Monica was speaking, eventually viruses, eventually cells. I have heard that in Schulten's group they are kind of trying a simulation of a bacteria. But perhaps you know something about that, Danilo. What we are doing... And this is an important thing. Regardless of the program you're using to calculate your simulations, the efficiency goes like n log n. We can discuss about this, but in general, all the calculations go with n log n if you are doing classics, with n being the number of the particles that compose the system. And if you put it in any arbitrary units, the computational cost, you see that the logarithm function goes after, say, 10 million atoms, just goes up, and the simulation of the system becomes untreatable. So what we are doing here, what happens? Okay, never mind. Yeah, there you go. So what we are doing with this force field, which is not written anymore anywhere, but the original acronym for this was South American Initiative for a Rapid and Accurate Hamiltonian. And I would like to go back to essentially to the first S at the end of the presentation. So what we are doing is trying to develop tools to run coarse-grained simulations combined with classical mechanics or with the atomistics simulations too. You know this stuff already, so I will not understand that. Which is important is to keep in mind is that whenever you run a simulation, the fastest motion that you have to follow or the thing that you have to be concerned is that you cannot do longer steps than the faster oscillations you are trying to be. In biological systems, this corresponds to the oscillation of hydrogens around oxygens. So eventually, you would be able to do long simulations, but with a speed limit that is about 2 femtoseconds or something like that. So this means that if you want to go to a cell and follow... where are you? Yeah. And follow a diffusion process in living cell, this is a real-time recording, you would have to be able to doing steps of 2 femtoseconds arrive to 2 seconds or something like that, which is a lot of computation, right? So perhaps this is not a very easy way to go, but people have think about some simplifications of that, and a very simple one is just one that allows you to go from a high level of detail. This is not high level, but it would be worse in this in the next high level of detail to a low level of detail using a kind of transformation matrix. The idea is that you go from here to here, kind of deciding based in your physicochemical or biochemical or biophysical or whatever you want to name it, intuition or knowledge about the system you are studying. Okay? In this case, if this is a protein, it would be a reasonable approximation to say, okay, I will take only one bit per each one of these monomers in the polymer. And this bit reasonably will coincide with the position of the C alphas. Okay? So that will take me from here to here, so from a high level of detail to a low level of detail, just removing all the atoms but the C alphas. Okay? This is just an approximation, and you can say, okay, well, actually, you know, if you consider the beta carbons, then you will have an idea of the directionality, and that would be a much better approximation. Okay, if you know that, it's okay. Again, this is like Fernando says, it's plain God. The main limitations here is that with your model, then you can reproduce reality, in a way. And actually, not every single detail of the reality, just the things that you are interested in. In the case of Monica's talk, it was the permeation of a small compound through the membrane. I mean, not the formation of hydrogen bonds between water and the compound, because they would be completely lost in that simulation. Okay? So these are things that you are saying that are not important. Obviously, the next problem appears because you have to decide the interaction parameters for these new effective interaction points. So you have to decide which is the distance between these C alphas and which is the eventually the dihedral angle and the bond stretching angles here. If you consider this, for instance, this example, and you know something about structural biology, then you should know that the distance between the C alphas changes if you go from an alpha helix to a beta strand. So perhaps this is not a good approximation. And then I should rethink everything and go back. Okay? Or I could have a function here that actually has two minima, or three, or many, so that I could allow for conformational transitions. Okay? This, everything is up to you. I mean, and this is something that usually is not written in the papers or in the books. This is the fundamental step in which you decide what are you trying to map into your simplified representation. In Fernando's stuff was mostly electrostatic interactions. Okay, so if you are trying to use Fernando's models for dealing with hydrophobic interactions, they will not work. I mean, the important thing is that he is aware of that, so he's not trying to describe hydrophobic interactions with his models. This is something that we have to keep in mind always. Other thing. Very important is that, I don't know if you can see that, but whenever you do this, so if you go from here to there, you will be losing degrees of freedom, okay? And this is essentially related, in this case, will be, for instance, related with conformational degrees of freedoms of this side chain here, or rotations around the backbone, or something like that. What does it mean? It means that if you have an atomistic situation in which you have an energy profile versus any generic coordinate, you have all this rugosity here. In a lucky day, your coarse grain profile will be something like this. Okay? And this has some deep implications in what you are going to interpret from the result of your simulations. One that is not so obvious is that, yes, you can reduce, of course, the number of particles here. So this simulation or simulating this by molecular dynamics would be faster than simulating this, okay? Because you have much less particles, and remember the story of n log n. Not only that, you can have a farther speed up because you can sum up all the masses of this, each of these points here into that one, and so since the frequency goes like the square root of m times the strength of the springs, then you will be able to go to lower frequencies, meaning to longer time steps. But also, when you do coarse graining, since you are completely erasing some degrees of freedoms, and now you think on what times means, and for this, perhaps it's good to remember Leandro's lecture yesterday. One could think that the time is the related to the to the period that happens between finding my particle here and here, and this is related to the essentially this is a probability function, and it's related to the height of this barrier. Okay, so if you have an energy that is I don't know somewhere here, then you will be sampling this region all the time. Eventually, once in a blue moon, you will jump to this one. If you are in a coarse grain situation, going from here to here would be spontaneous because there are no barriers. Okay, so this means that you will eventually be able to jump very easily from here to here if you admit that this situation here is representative of this situation here. Okay. Actually, this well, this is a kind of representation, and if I can draw, yeah. An important thing I will show you, and everyone that do coarse grain stuff will show you, is that they can reproduce, or we can reproduce, the structures of proteins or the structure of membranes or whatever. Suppose this is a folding landscape. Suppose this is a folding landscape of a protein. This is the one that you see in the papers, right? If I show you, and I will, that I can reproduce the structure of a protein, what I am saying is that in my landscape, I can be in something like a situation like this. Well, it's a different color. So the fact that I can reproduce a structure with here, with something here, actually doesn't tell me that the landscape is the same. The only thing that I'm saying here is that I have a minimum which corresponds with the minimum of the real, say, experimental protein, right? These are kind of things that one should keep in mind, because eventually I could jump just there and start sampling completely different things that are completely unrealistic, because, I mean, these states do not exist in this region, right? Okay, so let's go back to the story of the parameter. So we suppose that we have a situation, a molecular situation, we can simplify somehow. And so how do we do to develop the parameters? Well, there are actually two big ways of doing that. These are defined as bottom-up and top-down strategies. Bottom-up strategies are also called systematic derivation of parameters. Usually people that do systematic derivation of parameters say that the people that do top-down are not rigorous in their derivation, and it is correct. Usually people that do top-down say that this is rigorous, but only for one single point in the phase diagram. So despite the rigorousness, it's useless. But actually, as in any system or in any situation, one has to recognize that each approximation has weaknesses and strengths. Two of the most famous ways of doing systematic derivation for parameters is Boltzmann inversion and force matching. Essentially, the idea is that you have a simulation, suppose at high level of detail. And from that simulation, you will extract the information to build up your set of parameters in the coarse grain situation. Perhaps the most famous and more straightforward way of doing this is the so-called Boltzmann inversion. And it's so stupid that these are the kind of things that when one sees that, I could have that idea too. It's not that complicated. So essentially, what you need is a reference system which is a higher detail. Higher detail that does not necessarily mean that you need an atomistic situation. You could also have quantum level simulations or whatever you want, which is just at the higher detail of resolution than the one you want to go. And you're supposed to have a good sampling of the positions and velocities. So if you have a good sampling, then the probability for an event to happen would be expressed like this. And this is a Boltzmann distribution. And from there, it is immediate to realize that if you can express, I mean, if this is a magnitude that you want to measure in your systems, like, for instance, the distance between two bits suppose that you want to coarse grain a solution. And you have water and electrolytes in the solution, right? So what you will see is that the electrolytes eventually go approach. They like each other, but they like more to be in solution. So they will experience some short encounters, and they will diffuse away, right? A way to coarse grain that situation could be, for instance, just to get rid of all the water and also only keep the information for the ions, and then the probability function in this case would be how many times I need a function for the potential energy that reproduce the behavior of the ions. Okay, and I could do that just calculating the probability of encounters, and I can easily get rid of the partition function, and just make a Boltzmann inversion, and this is the origin of the name, so that my new potential energy will be just kT log n of the probability function. Okay? And that's it, in a way. That's it if this is a real probability, meaning that this has to really sample the entire conformational space. In the case of ions, that's kind of easy to say. In the case of a protein, actually, you don't know. So these kind of approaches actually do not work very well for very heterogeneous polymers or systems in general. But for polymer systems that are homogeneous, work very well. And eventually, you can do an iterative process in which you just compare whether the reference probability function is similar or not to the one you have, and then eventually you can do an iterative Boltzmann inversion. Some of the problems that this approximation has is that you are implicitly assuming, because of the logarithm here, that the degrees of freedom are independent. So meaning that the probability of, in this case, beta, theta, and phi, B, theta and phi, are independent, so that the probabilities can be expressed as a product. And this is not necessarily the case. So if you have events that are correlated, it will not happen. And again, as I said at the beginning, it requires a complete sampling. For instance, if you have some peptides that undergo a cis to a trans to cis conformation, which is very unusual but exist, and in some cases it is important, then if you don't see it in your simulation, then you will not have it in your coarse grain representation, okay, because you never saw it in your simulation, so you cannot be able to kind of extrapolate those kind of results.
You have it wrong, actually.
Sorry?
With the wrong energetic.
Right, because you saw it once.
Sampling it in.
Yes, right, yeah. So even if you have it, you may not, I mean, just let me kind of paraphrase what you're saying, that even if you have the, suppose, I mean, these cis peptides occur, and if you go through the PDB, of course, I think once every 10 times, I mean, in every peptide bond, once every 10,000, you see a cis peptide, okay? Let's assume that this is what you will be seeing in your simulation. You will, if you have a long enough sampling, then still you will be seeing very few events of this. And so perhaps you have one, or perhaps you have two, and then your sampling will be poor, so you will be assigning, as Guillermo said, a completely wrong weight in your energy function. Okay? Or if by any chance you win the lottery and you see that five or six times, then you will have quite low energy for that, and you will increase the probability. Okay. The second most famous method is force matching, and the idea here is also very simple. Suppose again you have a fully tight simulation. The idea is that I can, again, looking at this system here, suppose now it's just this peptide, so I can run the simulation and calculate the forces, the average forces between these bits that came out because of the identity of these amino acids. Okay? Interrupt me whenever you want. Okay? So if I can measure the forces during my detailed simulation, then I could be able to generate parameters for that. Okay? The problem here, this is essentially written here, the reference forces would be the masses of these new bits that are expressed as a particular wave function for the forces divided by the masses of a defined grain level. So this is what comes out from this simulation. This particular weight function, parameters have to be calculated from these systems of equation. But usually, it's not a problem because you have a long enough simulation, and in principle, you should be able to solve a relatively long matrix. The problem here is that, suppose that this is, I don't know, an alanine, valine, phenylalanine, and tryptophan, whatever. Then these parameters will be valid only for this sequence. Okay? So if you introduce a mutation here, then suppose that now I change alanine and phenylalanine here and substitute by lysine and glutamic acid. Then these two will experience, I'm just making the examples as I speak. So, suppose this is an iron and this is a phenylalanine. So they will experience a hydrophobic interaction, right? And so the force between these two bits here will be attractive. Now, suppose I do a mutation putting a glutamic acid here and a glutamic acid here. So they will repel. And now, obviously, the function or the force between these two bits will not be the same, will not be valid. Okay? So you have to redo every time your parametrization. And again, if you are, for instance, dealing with folding of proteins, then you have to really be sure that you are sampling the entire conformational space, which is not necessarily an easy task. Actually, can be impossible.
Yeah.
Sure.
Are beads supposed to be spherically symmetrical?
The beads can be whatever you want. I mean, you are the god in this universe. And in fact, there are, I mean, the one of the very first force fields for coarse-grained representation, which was developed way before this and get the name of coarse grain, is UNRES, was derived by the group of Harold Sheraga in the United States like 30 or 40 years ago already. And they have kind of ellipsoids that represents, and I think they are the main components of the revolution solid of the amino acids. So. But there are, when I started to work on coarse grain, and I once met my PhD supervisor, and I told him, "Hi, Paolo, I'm working on the coarse grain model," and the answer was yes. Now every physicist wants to make his own coarse grain model, and this is the reality. I mean, there are so many coarse grain models, it doesn't mean that is right or wrong. So this is more or less a very short overview of systematic derivation. Then for top-down or heuristics, then the rules are less clear, and essentially it's a lot of trial and error. For sure, if you have ever heard the words coarse grain, you have also heard about Martini. Which is by far the most famous force field. essentially, I think not for proteins, but for membranes, is for sure the best approximation on the market. The idea is essentially that they have a kind of golden mapping rule in which they whatever they find in an all atomistic situation for atoms, for heavy atoms, they map into one bit. And that gives place to a lot of possible representations for essentially for, they started with lipids and water, and then they also moved to proteins, and now last year they published a paper with DNA. In this case, as I said, the rules are not so clear. What they decided to do is that for the bonding interactions, they use force matching, because they have a lot of simulations on membrane, but for the non-bonded interactions, they use a kind of ad hoc approximation, which is called shifted Coulomb and shifted van der Waals interactions, in which all the interactions are multiplied by a switching function that turns everything to zero after 1.2 nanometers. And eventually, in newer developments, they have also included particle mesh evil for long-range electrostatics, but this is only for, the electrostatic runs only for charged species and not for polar. And on top of that, they use, in the original parametrization, a dielectric constant, because the water, I forgot to mention, in their case, is one single bead that represents the excluded volume of a cluster of four water molecules. But since you have one single bead, then you cannot have partial charges on that, because if you have a charge, it will not be a neutral or liquid, but will be an ionic. And so actually, in water, only the interactions are only in the van der Waals or Lennard-Jones dispersion forces, so they cannot create a permittivity. Remember that the permittivity is the capacity of a liquid to store energy in form of a dipole orientation. There is no dipole in a van der Waals particle, so you don't have that. And so what they use is usually a constant dielectric for the field. The parameters, in any case, are having devised in a very clever way, fitting to free energies of partition, and that's why the membrane representations they have is for sure the best.
And that's some kind of Boltzmann version.
Yes, indeed, yes. And then, there are some tabulated parameters that are used to calculate the interactions. Okay, this is a good point to ask you if you have any question. No?
I have a question.
Students, or you're old, Munir. Younger people have priority.
I have a question about the correspondence between all atom simulations and coarse grain simulations for the time scale that the events occur. Is there a correspondence between the time scale?
It's very difficult to find a real correspondence with that, and this essentially because of this bad idea. Okay, because of this stuff I was telling here. Actually, I mean, this is something that I can draw. Obviously, I did this with my hand. But usually you don't know the landscape of your system. In things that like the ones that Leandro showed, you yes can have an estimation of the landscape, but this is only for a few coordinates, not for the real all the possible coordinates. So you don't have a real idea of this, and that's why, and actually you will never be, you could do this comparison if you knew some special coordination which you would have to learn the landscape, but not in general. And hence the time in going from here to here, which is related with the height of the barrier, also the probability of jumping, cannot be correlated with this, because you don't know this, and you don't know this in general. Okay, so what people do is, I mean, what would be safer is to say nothing about the time scale. That would be safer. But what you can do is just to compare some characteristic times in your system and see whether you can find experimental values to compare. So if you know, I don't know, for instance, that the protein will unfold or can form hydrogen bonds in a certain time because you know it from, I mean, in the DNA we compare with, for instance, NMR data. Because with spectroscopy data you can follow the fast dynamics, and that's why we had an extrapolation that in DNA the system goes like 10 times faster. But with fluorescence correlation and stuff like that. But in general, I would not be sure that approximation that we made for DNA is valid for the entire force field. So it's really difficult stuff. Munir.
I want to ask a question. The problem. So Guilherme was saying, in the end, you always do some sort of a Boltzmann inversion technique because there is no way out of Boltzmann. However, the level of the inversion, which is the problem at heart here, right?
Mm-hmm.
How accurate is the inversion if you can measure that? So I've seen coarse grain models that the person takes an atomistic simulation of 100 picoseconds in vacuum and then with some little spheres there and say, well, okay, now we have a coarse grain model for this and that. Obviously, that is a very, very bad inversion of the Boltzmann problem. Is there a way to quantify this? Also, on the other extreme, you have people like Greg Voth and this, you know, guys with big names that always advocate, oh, the inversion problem, we are not doing the martini bullshit. Right. However, it's a very complicated problem.
It is.
So how can you quantify, is there a way, first of all, is there a way to quantify how good or how bad is your?
I mean, you can do this iterative stuff and see whether you really conversion on the energies, but at the very end, I think the important or this is kind of the heuristics part. This is my vision. The important stuff is that you have to reproduce the experimental data. Even if you are doing some shortcuts that could not be completely correct. Because some of the things I find difficult to understand, or actually, I never, when I started to do coarse graining, I started to do force matching with the sequences of DNA. Once I had a model, then I changed the sequence, and the model was not good enough to reproduce all the possible variations. And in that case, I only have four nucleotides. And so I decided that at the very end I could integrate somehow in my mind the information because of my previous formation and kind of doing a model which could capture some specific experimental information and not everything. And I decided to not, I mean, I decided that if I could, please. That I could just get rid of. I mean, the question is perfectly valid. I don't know the answer. Besides just doing the numeric, being sure that numerically your values are at convergence. In general, the point is that you have to reproduce experimental.
So in the end, the nice thing or the important thing to do is to make heuristic adjustments. In the early days before we just did atomistic simulations, we used to fight the quantum chemist guy. Just said, where are your electrons? And I said, my electrons are here, they are not here. And, right, so if you try to devise a force field potential for condensed phase liquid, trying to map the quantum energy landscape, you get nonsense, right?
Yeah.
In the end,
Yeah.
You get analytical potential that fits the quantum energy. Good.
Yeah.
But
that will not describe.
Doesn't work.
Yeah. Will not be useful for any description. Yes. But it happens at all the levels. I mean, even if you want, I mean, you know, if you go with the DFT, and then you will sell that as a parameter-free simulation, like Carparinello I used to did in my PhD students. It's not parameter-free because, I mean, there are a lot of things you're setting. You're setting the mass, the pseudo mass. You're setting the pseudo potentials. You're setting a lot of things. If you go to atomistics, I mean, the charges in the amber force field, which is I think is the best force field, are set heuristically to values that, I mean, the idea was great, that the RESP idea is great, but at the very end they fix with a hammer some of the values. So in general, yes, I mean, the theory is nice, and Boltzmann is always Boltzmann. But you realize that when you go to the real stuff, it somehow doesn't add. Perhaps it's the loss of three body interactions because we are mostly using two body Hamiltonians. I don't know what's really the problem, but actually, it's like you said, it would fit very nicely the equations, but it won't be useful. What is it? Do you mind? Yes, tell me.
It's
Well, yes, sure. I don't know what it is, but for sure there are many things we are missing. And I will say that it's as I said, you can reach a very high level of mathematical description, but at the very end, what matters is your perception of the physics or chemistry in the systems that tells you that you have to decide for one bit and not the other, and there is no mathematics behind that. This is just a purely heuristic approximation. I mean, Greg Both or whoever. Sorry, say again?
So the DFT is usually when they construct a functional, there's a sort of a current that you'll follow some performal constraints in order to construct a functional.
Yeah.
That
could be, again, could be hard to implement. I don't know exactly how.
I mean, I'm talking about heuristics even, but instead of using heuristics, you would use two sense of a fundamental.
That's I mean kind of the things that I mean simplifying a lot that I mean some kind of golden rules to map things and say okay I will not within the physics but within the practical approach like Martini for instance they say okay four heavy atoms is one bit and one bit that has 70 atomic units of mass. Whatever. I don't care where the four heavy atoms are, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, or whatever it is. So, in some cases you can use some kind of boundaries to limit what you're doing, and that for sure will help you a lot in the derivation of new parameters. For instance, there are people who have done this for trying to make it compatible with Martini for ligands. So you give your compound, and they, I think it's the group of Kramer in Mainz, in Germany. They have a server, I think now, in which you can submit your compound, and you'll get your coarse-grained version for Martini. The point is that when you go to the ligand protein recognition, you have a lot of hydrogen bonds, small hydrophobic interactions. I mean, a methyl group, more or less, it will take you from nanomolars to micromolars in the reality. So I don't know how possible is that. I mean, nobody have shown that. Sure. Okay, so I've been speaking for 40 minutes. I will just very rapidly show what do we do. The picture already tells you that we are on the heuristics a lot. So our idea is essentially that we try to, we don't care about atomistic or quantum simulations. We just structure based. We fit on structures that comes from the PDB. We can get some ideas from the flexibility if we use NMR structures, and that's it. So we don't compare against simulations usually. And the idea is that our kind of golden recipe, which is not actually a recipe, is that we decide which are the interaction points that we want to define, and we keep those points, and not that there's not nothing like 4-to-1 or kind of that. If you are interested, you know, you cannot see that, but. You can check the on the web page. You can download some of the parameters. In the afternoon, we'll have a hands-on on that, following some of the tutorials. So this is the periodic table of CIRA. Actually, there are a few elements now that are not included here. But essentially, this is what we have up to this moment. This is the for 20 amino acids. Four nucleotides and sodium, potassium, chlorine, and water. Okay, so this is we are having some. No, we have some one lipid actually, not lipids. We haven't published that yet. But essentially, if you have a problem that involves proteins, DNA, or electrolytes, it will help you. Just very rapidly about the electrolytes, the water model, which is fundamental and will be related with the last part of the presentation. The idea on the water model again is that we fit on the structures and not on simulations. And luckily enough, water is a structured liquid. So whenever you have a water molecule, you have the two hydrogens, and not depicted here, but you have the two lone pairs. So one hydrogen here is making a hydrogen bond with the lone pair here, and the same for all the rest. So this is an elementary water cluster, which we map into the positions of these four oxygens here. So now we go to a situation in which we had a small tetrahedron, which is a water molecule, to a big tetrahedron, which is something that we call WAP4. Okay? So it's four bits of water. These are some of the parameters. Importantly, since we have more than one bit, and even a number, we can include partial charges on that. So this solvent can create its own permittivity, because obviously you realize that there is a dipole in there. And for ions, we have this version of the ion, which essentially is the ion plus the solvation shell, the first solvation shell. If you want, I can come back on this, but I mean, this is some of the properties we can reproduce. Believe me, if not, it's in the papers. The features are that each one of these actually represents 11 water molecules, not 5 as one would intuitively think. If you are interested, I explain you why. We have a permittivity which is higher, but it is still a permittivity. And importantly, if you prepare a solution, you will get the right debite and Becquerel length, and you can measure osmotic pressures, and this work okay. Diffusion coefficient of water and the dependence of that with the temperature is also okay. If you go to see the nucleotides, or actually the DNA, something which is important is that the entire force field works with the classical Hamiltonian, this one that you have in any of your MD engines, Gromax, Ember, NAMD, whatever. But here comes the heuristics part. Look at the different sizes of the bits we have here. We have one big bit for the phosphate, which actually represents the excluded volume. Then another one which represents the sugar. This one is for the C1 prime. And then you see that the sizes of these guys here are not the same than this one. And this is because if you consider the situation in the double helix, if these sizes were bigger, they would collapse against the other. So if you want to preserve the rise of the DNA, then you will have to have smaller bits and bigger bits. Okay? So this is complete empirics. It's something that we decide because we know the chemistry or the physics in the system. And on top of that, we put charges here, so we have a charge distribution that allow for the reproduction of Watson-Crick interactions. So the nucleotides recognize themselves without the need of any kind of ad hoc potential. If you go into the problems of this, notice that we don't have anything here or here. So if you want to reproduce Hoogsten or sugar edge interactions, you will not be able to do it with that. This is a model that only works for a double helix DNA. Eventually, you can have some loops, but not all kind of interactions. Okay? So this is about the limitations. Any time you decide, okay, I will pick this bit or these three bits here, then I will have the Watson-Crick, which is perhaps, I don't know, it's the most important, but for sure, the most famous interactions in DNA. But I will not have anything like other interactions, and this is particularly more important in RNA. Okay, because RNA has a lot of structure, so we don't have a model for RNA. But with this model, you can do stuff like melting, and you can vary the sequence and then the temperature and the length, and eventually you would be measuring different melting temperatures in your simulation. Or you can go. This is the very latest paper we are preparing, in which we are just checking for potent DNA interactions. This is a simulation of a small, where is this? Small piece of chromatin. This is the biggest piece of chromatin crystallized. So we have there is a crystal structure for that, and you can follow the dynamics of the nucleosome. This is a tetranucleosome, and you can follow also the dynamics of the internal parts. Which we were surprised about, because kinks spontaneously appear, and this increase the accessibility of the internal parts of the nucleus, and which could be important for binding of I don't know, histones or other proteins. Sorry. Ah. Sure.
How do you keep the protein structure, the secondary structure in that simulation? Constraints?
Well, it's not easy to imagine here, but I mean, this is the glycine is a backbone. Okay, so if you imagine that this is connected with this one, so this, suppose that this is a peptide, you have torsional dihedrals that
Shira maintains secondary structure of peptides.
No, it doesn't. I mean, you don't have to add constraints on that. So yeah, you have the minimum for helices and a minimum for beta strands in the Ramachandran-like plot, and something else for the turns. So in principle, and you can have transitions from one to the other. So you can eventually, suppose you rise the temperature, you will see an unfolding. A refolding we have seen, but just in very simple systems, essentially because of this story here. So if I take the protein far away from here, it may just not come back. But in principle, the protein can decide the secondary structure, sort of saying. So it's not forced to any kind of thing. So, okay, so this is for proteins. Well, this is just a table of the parameters. This is a paper of last year. I will not go into the details, but essentially, well, okay, you can check in the paper. There's no point in going to the numbers. But well, just a very simple thing. The bits are covered by the partial charge. So you see that, for instance, this is a lysine, and you have a big positive partial charge, which is here blue. And eventually you have this is an asparagine, which have eventually the possibility of forming hydrogen bonds with other amino acids. And there is an important trick, which we call the dark side of the force. And this is a way to solve the problems that we don't know how to solve. Essentially, whenever you run a molecular dynamics simulation, you have the bonding interactions and the non-bonded interactions. The non-bonded interactions contain electrostatics plus van der Waals, right? Van der Waals are calculated following combination rules, meaning that you have a set of parameters for sigma and epsilon in the van der Waals function. And this is okay. Usually, most of our bits follow that rule. But in some particular cases, which are essentially related with electrostatics, they don't. This is the interaction matrix. These are all the possible bits in the force field. And whenever you have a white dot, it's okay and it follows the combination rules. But in some cases, like for instance, I don't know, this is a lysine here interacting with a chlorine. There is a modified van der Waals parameters because the chlorine is too attractive with the lysine and we don't have the proper screening. So we decided just to push them apart. So when they interact, although they have a strong electrostatic interaction, the van der Waals is corrected so that we can compensate for that. Okay, this is kind of tricky, but helps us a lot with electrostatics, or kind of to balance electrostatic interactions. And this is how it looks. Sure.
So that means that your topology file somehow has to include all those possible interactions between two.
Yeah, parts. but we do it for you. I mean, you don't have to set every time each parameter. Actually, and you will see this afternoon, so I won't use much of the time. But the only thing that you have to do is to download the force field, and for instance, we will see in Gromax. But if you put it in your working directory, Gromax will recognize that and will offer you an option like you have Gromos, Ember, or whatever. You have also Sira, and so you pick Sira, and then you will be working with Sira. And for all the rest, Gromax will not realize that this running coarse grain, because it will be running with the same Hamiltonian, and all these things are already pre-compiled in a way, in your they will be included in your topology. You can go and check for that. But you don't need to.
I'm thinking of the code. The code has to check what kind of interactions are there and then choose parameters.
Yes, in principle, yes. But since we have a finite number of bits, it's something that you do once and that's it.
EB2GMX will do the job.
Yes. Yes.
You use Gromax.
Yes. Or what's the name of the Python in Amber?
ParmD.
So there is also a post-processing. I mean, in Gromax, PDB2GMX. I mean, and everything is in the tutorial. You will see this afternoon. In Ember, there is also a post-processing Python file that will read the topology and write the correct topology. So all this will be transparent for you. So you will not realize it. So this is just a small slide, just as an example. This is an alpha helix at the fully atomistic level. Well, actually, it's not fully atomistic. The hydrogens are not there. But you see, this is a peptide that we know from experiments that are sensible to ionic strength, essentially because of the presence of two arginines, actually three arginines, which are consecutive in the helical context. This is how it looks like at the coarse grain level, and this is how it looks like, really, how it really looks like at the coarse grain level. So this here in yellow and green here are sodium and chlorine. This is the protein that now you cannot distinguish very well, and this is the water molecule all around. And this is just the right distribution functions, just to show that actually you can recover, I will skip the details, but actually you can recover a hydrophilic profile. So you have a first peak and then it relaxes, so the water really orients around the things. And this is something we did to test the sensibility of the force field. In the very first and most stupid approach, we just changed everything for whatever is the wild type, which is to glycine, and this is the initial structure, and this is helix, which is mostly helix, and helix drops in a few nanoseconds, and this is okay with and then you have mostly coil conformation. These times for unfolding are consistent with the glycine-rich peptides in which they are measured fluorescence correlation. So this goes, I don't remember who was the question about the time scales. You. I don't know if actually the time scale is the right one, but at least we see some things that suggest that, they do not prove, but they suggest that we are kind of in the right situation. And then we rise the temperature, and eventually we unfold the peptide, and then we decrease the ionic strength, and I don't remember which is this. This is with higher temperature. At a certain point, the helix just break, if you measure the root mean square deviation. And the red one is decreasing the ionic strength. So if we remove all the ions, then this interaction is too strong and eventually unfolds the helix. And then you can go to proteins and well. So, the nice thing about the Watt-4 model, which we discovered, later on, is that being, remember the story that the water molecule is in the classic force fields is a sphere, but ideally or in the reality is a tetramer. This, however, simplified the models, which are already coarse grained on their own, reproduce a two or three cluster around, which is pretty similar to this one, and the choice of the partial charges that I mentioned at the beginning was such that the partial charge here in this positively charged bit was the one in the hydrogen in an SPC model, which is a very famous one. And this in the oxygen is half of the one of the oxygen in atomistic water. So that you can mix them, and essentially a water that sees a Watt-4 around will not realize, take me in quotation marks, will not realize that it's not dealing with the real water. So they can coexist in a way. If you have this kind of situation, you will have some, I mean, this is the water is here in a fully atomistic representation. The coarse grain solvent is here in just in surface, just with a very few ones molecules, just to give an idea. And you see there is a limited mixing. There are some waters here or there, and well, some others swimming around. Also, some coarse grain can decide to go from this phase to that phase. And this is because if you calculate the free energy of solvation of water in coarse grain and coarse grain in water, they are both negative, but it's also true that it's always more convenient to stay in their own phase. So it results in a partial mixing in which this is now the density of the liquid, in which you have a high density for the atomistic. This is for the three models, TIP-3P, SPC, and SPC-E. And this is for the coarse grain. There is a rather wide interface, nearly 1 nanometer. But then if you sum up this plus this, this is what you get. So you are, and it's hard to see, but you see here, there is a dashed line with the experimental value of the density for water. The only thing, the only perturbation that you see appears in the here the interface, and this is because of there is an interpenetration of water in some cavities that usually would be void in the Watt-4 mol. So water gets into the intermolecular interstices of Watt-4 and generates a small cavity.
What time steps do you use?
Good point. For the time being, we are, if you go to this approach, we will be using 2 femtoseconds, so a normal time step. Now there are some programs are already implementing a multi-time step, which could boost this quite a bit. So at the end, what happens is that this is a situation in which the green points corresponds to the bits of the Watt-4. They're just small to be able to see something. This is the water molecules, and the bluish dots are atomistic electrolytes, and the reddish or yellow are coarse grain. So we started the simulation in a situation in which we have only one, and if you notice, this ion is in the coarse grain phase, but traveling with its own solvation, while the source remains there. So if you keep an eye on this guy here, two things happens. This guy swims around with its own solvation chain and eventually finds its way to the atomistic phase. But also notice that yellow and orange are completely expelled, say, from the atomistic phase and go to the solvation, to the coarse grain solvation. Also, there are some water swimming around here, and you can see some green spots here and there, which are account for this story of the limited mix. So if you put this, you can add it to eventually do a resolution models for DNA, that if you can put together with that, eventually you can you can arrive to have simulations in which you have coarse grain filaments, pieces of coarse grain filaments of DNA with the atomistic ones, with their own ions in the hot spot at the atomistic level. And with that you can do super cool stuff that Matthias did the last year, in which you have the operon lac system, in which you have the protein part at the atomistic level with the DNA, so this is the crystallographic structure, but we wanted to study the dynamics of the loop of DNA, but there is no information about that, so we treated that at the coarse grain level to see the dynamics of the loop and everything. So, okay. 1 hour. Are you still awake? Matthias, bring the wine.
That you were working with one liquid, you didn't say which one.
Yes, the MPC, the less useful at all. Just because it doesn't have a double bond in the lipid tail, so it's easier for us. Actually, we want the lipids only, at least for the time being, we don't want to go to study properties of the membrane. We just wanted to a lipidic environment for protein, for membrane proteins. So, and also from the strategic point of view, it's not wise to try to compete against Martini, for instance. So we don't want to really push in that direction.
Is it compatible with other coarse grain model, for example?
No, and I would not do that. I mean, the same way that I would not mix amber with Gromax, because actually, In the best case scenario, each force field at least is self consistent. I mean, the force fields, classical force fields may have many problems, but at least they have been tested to be self consistent one with each other. So I would not mix this stuff with the Martini stuff or systematic derivation stuff, because I don't know what happens. I mean, I don't know how to weigh the interactions. But in general, you should not also mix. I mean, suppose that you take a protein and I know alanine comes from amber and glycines come from Gromos 85. So would it? Whatever. So I will not do that.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
This is an old question.
Okay.
But the expectation is...
I hope I have a new answer.
Expectation has a different answer.
Okay.
Carbohydrate.
Okay. Okay, good point. Carbohydrates.
Not every carbohydrate.
that was
cellulose, one or two times.
Okay, no, I don't have a new answer for that. Now, for those of you that Murillo always ask me about carbohydrates, and I always give him the same answer. Carbohydrates are complicated because the stability is I mean, now I'm not speaking to you. the stability or the structure, the secondary structure of the carbohydrates is kept by hydrogen bonds. In some of the cases, it has been measured that the hydrogen bonds between one and the next and the neighbor unit contributes a few, I mean, less than the energy that comes less than the thermal energy. Okay, so you may have a conformational transition in carbohydrates that work because each pair contributes 0.1 kcal per mole. When, if you don't remember, the thermal energy is 0.6, whatever. So and the conformational transition happens because it's a cooperative process. To coarse grain that is difficult. We have discussed this with Roberto, but we haven't yet made a. And one guy from Roberto's lab is in my lab now. If we have time, we will try to do something with cellulose. Yes. And by the way, I mean this guy is he came to a course in May last year, and he now came to my lab for 6 months because the system he was interested in contains a magnesium ion, and we don't have magnesium ion. So I invite him, so we kind of see where or how we can get the money. But for a relatively short period of time, you can go to the lab eventually, and if you are interested in a particular amino acid or a particular something, whatever, we can just try to solve that. Carlos is supposed to be there for 6 months, but in 2 weeks he already solved the problem. So now we are seeing what the hell is he going to do for the next month. So I was saying that it's not that complicated, and at the very end it's just trial and error with the Van der Waals parameters. So
as you don't have coarse grain coarse for carbohydrates, would it be possible to model fully optimized carbohydrate in one form?
Yes, I mean this kind of thing you could do. The problem is that No, I mean the force field is now implemented to work on Gromax and Ember. None of them have the dual time step. So when running this, you run always with a time step of 2 femtoseconds. While if you go with the full coarse grain, you go with 20 femtoseconds. So it's tenfold increase in the velocity. Or actually, you are losing. So you are going 10 times slower. But yes, you could, actually, I don't have an example, but I can show you, we have an example of carbohydrates. It worked, I think, well, just in two words, the only way in which we made it to reproduce NMR spectra of the carbohydrate was growing big enough to be comparable with the size of the particle that is in the tube of NMR. So yes, it can be done. I can show you if you're interested.
But you still get some speed up, right?
Because of the solvent, and you have much less solvent in your system. So in this case, well, here you see this is the water, the atomistic water, and all this big box is the solvent that you need to stabilize your system, which is usually 75-80% of the system. So this just finish. This kind of approaches can grant you a speed up between 2-fold and 5-6-fold, depending how much solvent you can substitute from your system.
You might be able to do the hydrogen mass reportioning in the MM zone. So
see.
Si. Yeah.
Yeah, could be.
But in fact, this is a mixture of force field, too.
Yes. The point is that what for was designed to match the atomistics. So it's still self-consistent. Kind of. Be nice with me. Yeah, kind of.
Well, you show that if you put a solute there, coarse grain solute has a preference for the coarse grain water, and atomistic solute has a preference for atomistic water. So when you mix the two, you expect to have the right I mean, you have a coarse grained water with atomistic solute. Won't that be some kind of forced separation on the inputs?
Well, no, but it do generate a problem. What you will have at the end is something like this. It's like mayonnaise. An emulsion. This is kind of the behavior is like an emulsion, and you can also playing with the amount of water. I mean, in this case, what we did was just to prepare a system very well ordered, and then we heat up the system, and we see that it starts to behave like an emulsion. And you can have a phase inversion if you change the. It's like when you do the mayonnaise. If you put too much oil, then you will have a phase inversion. Usually your grandma will tell you to throw it away, but actually there's nothing wrong with that. So the two system mix only limitedly because of the similar free energy of solvation. However, you do have an effect, which is an effect related to the interfacial tension. Whenever you have two liquids, I mean, it's the same that happens in a capillary tube when you have a meniscus. And this happens in that case, and we saw it, actually we realized that, well, because of, thanks to a reviewer in a paper, but then we saw it also, it doesn't have an effect on proteins because if they are well folded, they can resist the pressure. But with carbohydrates, since they are linked by sigma bonds in the glycosylation, in the glycosidic links, they are much flexible and they tend to compact much more than, because there is an effective force acting on that. That force is inversely proportional to the curvature, so if you have a huge system, that effect will decrease with 1 over R. But it exists, and yes, it's important.
Do you need necessarily to work with the two kinds of solvent to study the protein in dual resolution?
I mean, we tried what for together with SPC, SPC slash E, and T3P. And the three work very well.
Yeah,
well,
just the what for.
He doesn't allow me to say it's working very well. But they work decently.
No.
No, you're right. So yes, I mean, then we, I mean, is that your question?
My question is, if you need the SPC or T3, and what for, or you can work a protein in dual resolution just with
four? No, we tried that. No, it didn't work. So first of all, we don't have. We only have dual resolution for DNA. Because it is linear. When it comes to proteins, then eventually you could have, if you have a multi-domain protein, you could have a piece at the coarse grain level and the other piece at the fine grain level. Eventually we will go there, but we don't have it now. With DNA, it's easier because it's a linear molecule. And so at a certain point you say, okay, I cut here. But suppose that you have a beta strands that go far in the sequence and come back, and then it would be difficult to match a coarse grain with a fine grain strand in the beta strand. So we don't have that. But there are other guys that have done this, that they have proven that they can solvate with coarse grain water only, and not they have the membranes at the atomistic level. I think it's the group of Essex. And they use another kind of coarse grain water. We tried that, and what happens is that since the mass of what for is much higher than the mass of one single water, and they are all because they are all together, this solvation, I mean, we were quite happy at the beginning because it keeps the folding, but actually it frees the folding because it's like being surrounded by a very viscous environment.
Like a hydrophobic effect?
No, because you can observe also hydrophilic interactions because we use the trick that in that case WAT4 can get in touch with an OH of a serine or whatever, But whenever these interactions form, since Watt4 is more heavy, is a much more heavy object than a single water molecules, the substitution with the solvent is much slower. And so the proteins, I mean, the crystallographers use this trick, they put heavy ions.
Yeah. Because when you have a hydrophobic solute immersed in water, it will have a cage effect.
That yes.
Slower, that's the surface.
Yes, right.
In that simulation, like you have the two models, the coarse grain model and the atomistic model of water, can you check it how far from the interface between the models is the water structure completely restored?
I know, it doesn't change at all. Let me see. I will show you later on, but no, it doesn't change. If you consider the redistribution function of pure water and water here, and you consider also the contribution of Watt4, the match is perfect. And this, in my opinion, is because they don't realize that they are... Actually, there is one single defect, which is a small shoulder at 3.7 angstroms in the water distribution. However, this is a position which is occupied, which you can see in supercooled water. Because it's water that is not making hydrogen bonds with the other water. And this is what for. It's water that does not really make a hydrogen bond with water. Now this comes really nice. Not all the rest, but...
Can you show us the protein slide you pass it through by the bond?
Which one?
I think that one.
This?
So
this is a secondary structure. Yes.
That's my main point here, and I think that's the worst or the mean thing about Martini is that it doesn't maintain secondary structure. And
no, it does maintain. It enforces the secondary structure.
If you remove the constraints, it will unfold. it doesn't have electrostatics.
Yeah.
It doesn't have hydrogen bonds, so. Mm. So we would like to use such a kind of coarse grain potential for proteins. Is it ready for it? I mean, does it maintain secondary interest yet?
Most of the times. We have problems with small loops because we can, in some cases we have realized that the tension in small loops cannot be relaxed because of the loss of and the risk of freedom, and this is it is worse in small proteins.
Okay, but they have less mobility, but they
no, they can unfold. Yes, if you have small protein domains, say four helix bundle with small loops, perhaps there are many in which you have two prolines. And so in those cases, if the length of the helices is not long enough to hold the protein as a whole, they cannot unfold. But for big stuff, things work much better because you have stabilization So yes, this is, just going to, since you ask, this is a cyclic nucleotide binding domain which recognizes an arginine there. This is the NMR, right, Martin? This is the NMR ensemble, and this is the coarse grain ensemble. When we first start to seeing the simulation, what happens is the root mean square deviation went up to 5-something, which was not so nice. But then we realized, and this is a plot that Matthias did, that if you adjust the root mean square deviation not against the starting conformer, but against every possible conformer in the NMR family, it just jumps from here to here or to there, or sometimes here. So it kind of mapping the state. It works very well for some proteins, not so well for others. For most proteins, it do well. I mean, if you are looking for a hydrogen bond, then don't go coarse grain, obviously.
Have you tried some membrane protein?
Yes, But this is, yes, we have a channel which is working nicely, but I don't have the data here. I can show it.
I imagine that it should be easy to have a atomistic model from a Cyrus-Postgres structure.
Ah, yeah, well, there are some tools to do that. I mean, you essentially, you will see this afternoon. What you need as an input is a PDB file, and you will need you need it protonated, because the position of some hydrogens are important for making hydrogen bonds. For instance, for serine, we need it, for threonine, we need it, for cysteine, we need the position of the hydrogen. But there is a clear recipe on how to do that. So, yeah. That is one command line will give you the coarse grain protein.
No, the contrary.
Okay. This is a different story. Yes. The answer is, the short answer is yes, you can. But be aware that we are kind of cheating with the reconstruction. I mean, you are losing things that there is no mathematical way to recover. But what we do is to use internal coordinates that take essentially some positions that we know because of organic chemistry. So we know that two carbons are at 1.54 angstroms, and we reconstruct in that way. But this is, you can recover atomistic structures, but you have to be careful about what you do with the results then. Because then, if you then start to say that you found a hydrogen bond that forms after a coarse grain simulation, then I will not believe you. Okay, Ruth, Munir, what do you say? How much time you give me? Minus 10?
No.
10.
You still have 20 minutes actually according to the schedule.
Really? Whoa. Okay.
it's entirely up to you.
No. Now I would like to show you the story of the virus. So, how many of you think that this is a reasonable approach? Please raise your hand.
It depends.
Great. Now.
All right. 10 minutes.
10 minutes. Okay. So again, how many of you think that this is a reasonable approach if you are not too much concerned about the precision of the story? Okay. So. If you already agree with that, why not? Why not to go in an increasing degree of granularity? So, if water is a tetrahedron, and you can go to a higher scale tetrahedron with Watt-4, then you could eventually go up as much as you want. I mean, you can say that this is the tetrahedron, and then you can have a higher tetrahedron, right? Now, this is already not water, I know it, and this is much less water, and I know it too. However, and I will skip all the details, but essentially, if you, again, this is the very same story, you have water, what for, what else? What else can swim eventually in what for? They can get into the interface. Same happened with water, much less likely because the free energy observation is much less favorable, blah, blah, blah. You can see that the sum of the densities, you remember there was a small peak here, there is a bigger peak here because the masses of these guys go into the interstices of this molecule called what else generate a bigger peak. Still, it is in the order of the 10% of the density. But it depends, right? So it depends what we want to do with that. I will just, you don't know this virus, and I will not go into the details because of the sake of time. You don't know it because it's not a human virus, it's a virus that attacks, how do you say?
Barbeiro.
Vinchucas, kissing bugs in English. Just we'll skip the description, but let me go to this point. Now suppose you can have a triple solvation scale that we can use just to fill empty spaces that are supposed that are not supposed to be empty, but are needed to keep the right solvation. Okay, I will never say that this is really water. This is kind of a buffer, whatever you want to call it. Okay, but then if you really can combine this with the coarse grain, I mean this coarser, or let me call it supramolecular coarse grain or supracoarse grain, with coarse grain and coarse grain with water, and water with its own proteins here, then you will have a system which contains nearly 1.3 million atoms, but represents nearly 7 million atoms. Okay? So if you remember the story at the very beginning about the computational cost, since we are dealing with logarithms, going from here to here, maybe the difference in saying that I can do it or I cannot do it. Okay? So we just did the story and then we set up this simulation. What you are seeing here, you're not seeing the details, but these are the all atomistic proteins. Notice also that we have this green stuff here and orange here are the coarse grain ions, and you will see also some green stuff here and orange are more difficult here, if you can see it. So these are the atomistic ions, and there is some magnesium around. But okay. And so if you do that, essentially you see, we did the simulations. Nice thing is that you see that spontaneously ions will locate into regions, particular regions in the capsid, which are related with the 5 symmetry axis, which, just go very rapidly, generate or correspond with a hydrophobic gate. But the nice thing is that they localize. This is valine 3012, and in this position, when you go to see the structure, there is the same position in which you have there is unassigned density in the crystal, and same when you don't have the ion, you don't have water. Red is for no water. When you have the ion there, then you have water, which is very localized, and essentially you have two peaks here, which at least are reminiscent of this peanut-like stuff here. Then we use that for other kind of coarse grain situations, and I will skip the details on this. But we kind of make it to rationalize the way in which the virus releases the genetic material. So I would just like to tell you what we are doing here, and this is because it's something I would like to propose you to find a spot this afternoon or tomorrow or whatever to have a discussion about who is interested in that. Because, well, of course, you know, I don't have to introduce the virus, and I think it would be great if we could set up a network of interaction at the in silico level, which could not deviate us that much from what we are doing, but just a kind of collaborative net. As I was saying this morning to Danilo, the virus has only 10 proteins, so in principle we could take one for each and do the simulations. And it would be kind of in silico proteomics of the Zika virus, which is a Nature title for a paper. So this, 1 month ago, this molecule, the envelope of Zika virus was released. It's a cryo-EM structure, 3.8 resolution. It became the molecule of the month in the PDB, and I just downloaded this this morning, this from the Center of Disease Control in the US, that tells us that the very updated information about where the virus is being transmitted, in particular here in Pernambuco, I think is the most affected area, in which it's not clear why, but there is apparently a higher prevalence of microcephaly and Guillain-Barré. The thing is that the variants that originally came or were isolated somewhere here in Africa, in Uganda, travel to Polynesia, they mutated there, and there was a first outbreak in 2012-2013, and they traveled to our continent, where they became apparently more infective. So I would just, in one slide, would like to tell you what we are doing with that. We started with the structure of the Zika virus. We set up the system in the same fashion I just described. Coarse grain water, sorry, what for and what for ions are in this lab. Do not get fooled by the dimensions. This is the diameter of this is nearly the external diameter is nearly 50 nanometers. So this is nearly 3 nanometers in water, which is already a lot. But the fact is that the water which is inside is really huge. Just a very few details of the simulation. We are just submitted a communication with this, but saying that essentially, well, saying that it can be done. Not only that it can be done. What comes up from the simulation is, well, the virus is essentially stable. We lost immediately the symmetry because you see that if you consider the root mean square deviation of the entire particle, it goes up to one or something nanometer. But this is only an oscillation. It's not really losing its shape. If you look at the level of a single protein, it is much smaller. And what we have seen is actually that introducing a couple of mutations from the African variants, just concentrate on this. This is a difference in root mean square deviation between the wild type minus the mutant, or the other way around. The mutant minus the wild type. So whatever is below zero is more stable during the simulation than in the mutation than in the wild type. Okay? So you see that in general, the mutant induces a stabilization in essentially in all the proteins, and especially in some of them which are related with symmetry axis. What we see is that there is particular stabilization in these points here. These are the fusion loops. And these are other loops that are in contact, that if you take into account they are not related in sequence, and they are not related either in the structure of the single molecule or a dimer, but they are related in the context of the quaternary folding of the pot. And this is something that we are trying to depict here. The red dots correspond to the mutations. You see the two mutations are here. This is one single protein, and the stabilized region are these two. But if you put it in the five-fold axis, then you see that actually the region is much wider, and it's in the vertex of contact. And the same happens with the threefold vertex. We can discuss about the details, but the point here I would like to make is that, and this is my very last slide. If you remember, 2 or 3 years ago, in 2013, the structure of the mature capsid of HIV was published by the group of Samson. It contains 64 million atoms. And they published like 100 nanoseconds of simulations. There was an entire capsid with full atom resolution. Okay? 200. Yeah. You're awake. Great. It needed blue waters, which costed like $200 million. Actually, more, because there were some issues with IBM. And so.
That's only for the hardware.
Yeah.
You have an installation, you have electric bill, and all that.
Yeah. Sorry?
Personnel.
Yeah.
Staff.
Yeah, sure. And running costs.
I was
cooling
it. It's apparently turning off because of the electric bill.
Hmm.
So.
Yeah.
The largest one in Brazil.
We did. This is a Matthias fantasy. We did 300 nanoseconds in 20 or 25 days. With a computer that costs $2,000, these are most. I don't know if you can see, but it's here. Essentially, The system contains again 1.2 million atoms in total, but this, if you consider how much it would be in full atomistics, is about 22 million atoms, which would be untreatable, not only from the point of view of the simulation, but also if you want to share the data or you want to simply write the files. In this case, even at the very coarse grain stuff, the space on disk for 5 nanoseconds is 1 gigabyte. So the space on, I don't know how much space they use for that. So the message here is that using not the approach that I am showing, but any other approach, this is connecting with the first part of making fruit salad with lemons. So we can make a reasonably decent fruit salad with lemons if we put some sugar.
You can make some caipirinha as well.
Yeah. Who wants fruit salads when you can have caipirinhas? So that's a good a good point. it goes in the direction of trying to make a smart use of computer power and resources that is really affordable. That's the main point. In principle, sure.
They simulated 200 nanoseconds. The kind of conclusion they obtained with this 200 nanoseconds would be different from the kind of conclusion you could obtain with a coarse grain model.
It is hard for me to say which were the conclusions of that paper. If anyone can tell me, they concluded
muscle power.
Yes. They concluded that they can do it, and so they do it. I don't know. I don't want to be aggressive in this, but actually, if
they do make some discussion about the interaction.
I didn't read the paper, but I imagine that some kind, like you did in your case of the Zygomatic.
Yes.
I imagine they did some discussion about the functionality resulting from.
Honestly, I don't remember. I read the paper a couple of times, and I don't remember something I said, ha, now we understand this. But I'm not saying I'm not saying that this simulation was useless. Perhaps they just didn't analyze that deep enough. Or perhaps I was just not interested in the paper. And I'm not saying either that our conclusions are meaningful. However,
I'm just saying that this is a case where you could eventually compare the kind of discussion that was performed on the simulation with a result.
I'm going there. The point is that at the very end, if you have to interact with people doing experiments, you have to reach the level of the single amino acid, which is something you can do with the coarse grain. Because at the molecular biology level, they won't discuss much about the single hydrogen bond or quantum effects. They will just go to see whether a mutant is more stable or more effective or more whatever. So you can reach that level of resolution with the coarse grain models, not only ours, many others. So to finish, I would like to propose a kind of, I know some of you are already working on stuff related with Zika. I know there is a lot of money, there are many international calls, something that we could eventually apply for, and that's it. If you want, we could just decide this afternoon or tomorrow. I say this afternoon or tomorrow because some people is leaving. So
after 4?
No, no, because there are some lectures, so it should be later.
Ah, okay, perfect.
So I have some bottles of wine if you want. Guillermo will prepare caipirinhas. And we can meet. I'm not saying that we have to decide right now, but we can meet in the lobby or wherever to just see whether it is possible or not. Okay, thank you very much.
Just a question.
Sure.
In your simulation of the Zika virus,
yeah.
have you analyzed the internal motion of the entire capsize? Which no. type of motions do you have in the simulation?
Not really much, because I am doing the same that I blame Schulten to have done. We just wanted the paper to go out immediately. Now, what we are planning to do is to do a more wide screening with all the variants. I mean, to compare the African variant with the Brazilian variants, for instance. And try to understand whether they are more stable or not, or whether the epitopes for the antibodies remain the same or not, or same comparison against dengue, for instance.
And it's possible to use your coarse grain model with implicit solvent model.
We are trying, and we haven't tried for this one. We are trying to implement in generalizable model with Ember, but it's not working so well so far. So we really have to, I mean, the proteins unfold a bit more than in the already crappy birds. Yeah, I don't know if Munir was, you want to say, do you want to say something? No, sorry.
Am I supposed to say something?
No, I just...